My wife dragged me to the upstairs.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
How's everybody doing?
Cold.
I'm glad you're so excited to be here. I'm excited to be here. I hope you are too. It is good to be here this morning. Everybody adjusting to the September schedule now? Labor Day is over, and now some of you, the schedule doesn't even change, does it? Doesn't matter whether it's September, July, or it's just another day for you.
We all seem to get to nowhere.
Yeah. For some of us, the schedule changes. You parents know, you bus drivers know. Yeah, it's all a little bit different, but everybody adjusting pretty well. It's getting a little cooler. It's not 95 anymore. For all you hot summer-loving people. So, could stay kind of in 65, 75 range for me all the time. But it is good to be here. Football season starts today. Do you know that? Steelers play at 1 o'clock.
It started Friday.
Huh?
It started on Friday.
For some of you. Some of us had to work Friday. Everybody excited about that? No? Man. All right. Next week is Back to Church Sunday, so let me talk a little bit about that before we get started. There are these little invitation cards on the offering tables up here, so we encourage you again to think about inviting somebody to come next week. We are going to do a blessing of the backpacks for the kids, and hopefully we'll have a little surprise for them if they get here in time. We will have food truck here, again, just to share our love and care and support back to you. It's going to be a good day. It's a good day to invite people to come to church and see what we're all about in the live version. So we want to invite the people online to come and join us if you can as well. We always appreciate you joining us and being here as a part of Way of Hope. But come out and enjoy the fellowship and the festivities here as well. We hope that we can pack the place full. And typically, I'll say this again later, but typically, you know, we double in size on those kinds of days. We're around 50, 55 usually. We're usually 90, 95, 100 on those days. And I don't know exactly what that says, but it does say something, right? It tells me that you can encourage people to come here. It tells me there's probably a whole lot of other people that could be here in the body of Christ as well. So I encourage you to encourage people to come. Today we're going to talk a little bit about labor again. Since last weekend was Labor Day, I thought maybe as we bridge into Back to Church Sunday, we'll talk a little bit more about our work. Last week was about being labor ready to serve in the church. Going to flip that a little bit today and talk a little bit more from the secular side of things, how we should operate as workers. So prepare yourself for that. Some of you have already got a little hint of what's coming with that, so stay tuned for that. I also do have a sign-up sheet to go around for pies and cakes for next Sunday, for Back to Church Sunday. So I'll start that over here on this side. And you can pass that around. You can help us with pie, cake, something. We would certainly appreciate all that. So before we get started, anything else we need to know? Quick, pray with me, and we'll worship this morning. That's what we came here to do, listen to God's word and to worship him. He is worthy of all of our praise, so let's give him thanks. Lord, again, as we just humble ourselves before you this morning, it is good simply to be here, gathered together. And we pray, Lord, that you would encourage us and guide us as we move through this day. Help us to think about people that we can invite here, Lord, to enjoy the fellowship and the worship together next week. And we pray even more sincerely, Lord, that all of us would have a deeper desire to draw close to you, to be here, to fellowship together, to be a part of your church and your kingdom, to be your children, Lord. We love and praise you. You're faithful in all the things that you do, Lord, and your promises, they endure forever. And there's no limit to your miracles. And Lord, we want to share that kind of stuff with everybody that we know. Lord, we know that in your hands that all things are possible. And you're the one that conquered death. You made a place for us in heaven. Lord, we want to share that message. We want to show people that that is true. Lord, we pray today that none of us would never stop singing your praises. You are worthy of all praise. Creation praises your holy name. And Lord, we want to be a part of that. We want to be attuned to that. We want to be the loudest voices in all of that. Lord, we pray today that we might never cease to work to build your kingdom. Help us to never be apathetic. Help us to never turn our backs on you. Help us, Lord, to never be complacent, but to continue, Lord, to share the good news of Jesus Christ with the world. May we never cease to be your witnesses in the world, the way we live our lives, the way people see us. Help us, Lord, to be your arms, your hands, your feet. Help us to be good witnesses in the world for your kingdom. Today, Lord, as we humble ourselves, we ask that you would prepare us today. Prepare our hearts, Lord, to hear your word and to put it into action. That's why we're here, Lord. You know that. Help us to know that. Lord, plant your word deep in our hearts that it might become part of our DNA, that we might live it out, breathe it out, day in and day out. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for being the God of the possible and the impossible. We give you all praise today in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're able, let's stand and sing.
All things are possible. Come on.
Yeah.
Have a seat this morning. We're here to serve the God of the impossible and possible. And it's good that we can. It's good that we can serve Him with our hands and feet. It's good that we can serve Him with our finances as well. So we thank you for all of your giving. Pray with me this morning as we think about how we can continue, Lord, to build. Think about how we can continue to build the kingdom for the Lord is what I want to say. So join me as we pray. Father, again, we are just grateful to be here. And if we're here again, Lord, to think about being labor ready and our work here in this world, Lord, both for your kingdom, but the work that we simply do day by day that supports us, that encourages us, that motivates and moves us, Lord. We know that work requires some effort. And today, Lord, we're grateful for the strength that you give us, for the motivation to get out of bed in the morning and let our feet hit the floor. We thank you for our health and our healing and the blessings that you give us day by day that we might encounter every day and step up to work, Lord, in a way that honors and pleases you. We know that this effort that's required requires some passion. And Lord, we're grateful that you've given us passions in life and gifts and ways that we can operate and function and work. Lord, we all don't have the same passions about life, but that's what makes it so extraordinary and so wonderful and so excellent, Lord, that we can look through the world and we have doctors and nurses and we have truck drivers and bus drivers and we have lawyers and we have all kinds of people. We have administrative people that help the world move and tick and grow. Lord, we're grateful that you supply all these gifts and passions to people, and we just praise you for it. Lord, today as we think about our giving, may we always have the passion to serve you well. Lord, we know that all these other things are important, but you are the most important thing. And today, Lord, we humble ourselves before you to praise you and to honor you, to speak your words that you've given to us, Lord, to learn from them, to teach them to others, to apply them to our lives, Lord, that we might grow in faith, that we might grow to be more like your Son, Jesus Christ. So today, as we're gathered here, it's all not for naught. It's all here for a purpose. And today we come humbly to love you and to share with you and to give back just a portion of what you've already blessed us with. So today we pray that you would ignite the passion within us, Lord, to live for you and live for you alone. Lord, we thank you for all that you do. We thank you for this time of giving, the offering that comes today. We ask your blessings again. We ask you to multiply it. But most importantly, Lord, continue to give us the wisdom and discernment to use it in ways that is glorifying and pleasing to you. Lord, we thank you for all that you do. We thank you for these people that come and give so faithfully. Lord, bless them, encourage them, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Come and give. Let's sing a little more. Walk, walk, I suppose to walk.
things of earth are dimming.
Our eyes on Jesus this morning. Let's take some time for prayer requests this morning. What would you like to share? How's God working in your life? Some testimonies, some praises, some concerns. How is it that we should spend our time today praying? All right, start with Miss Kathy.
Hi, yes, Bill's going in for a test on Wednesday. So prayers for
all right, Mr. Rauch, or Mr. Rauch is going for tests. Okay, on Friday, right? Right, Bill. Friday.
Wednesday.
Oh, Wednesday.
Wednesday.
Sorry.
I have a lot of praises. I mean, we haven't been here for a while. Jim had something taken off the back of his ear, and it came back right away. It was negative.
Good.
So that's a praise. And 2 weeks ago today, my nephew and his family, their house burned down on Equatorial Road.
That was the Haruska family.
Haruska.
Yeah, we've been praying for them, sure. Go ahead.
They all got out and even went back in for the dogs. And we're really thankful for that. We were actually away in North Dakota when this happened. My sister was with us.
Mm.
So we ended our trip a little earlier, but that was okay. We needed to get back.
Sure.
And right now, for the past 2 weeks, they've been living with my sister and her husband in a small house.
Mm-hmm.
And we were reaching out, someone in Conemaugh Township, if anybody had a house. Well, my brother-in-law went to a men's prayer breakfast yesterday, and sure enough, there's a house right down the road from my sister.
Good.
So they'll hopefully be moving in there soon.
Good.
So we have a lot to be thankful for.
Okay. And that's cousin, you said, right? The family?
My nephew.
Nephew, okay, thanks. My hearing's getting older these days, you know. Go, Elise.
Bill had a doctor's appointment. Doctor kind of panicked and sent us to the ER, thinking Bill might have a pulmonary blood clot in his lung. So right away started having everybody pray. And there was no clot. Everything is okay in that respect. And I guess 6 hours in and out of the ER wasn't bad these days, because I was praying that that we wouldn't have a long wait. So I guess maybe he answered that prayer too.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm just grateful and thankful for everybody that I can call on when we have issues like that. And
praise the Lord.
My church family and my family that immediately start lifting it up and glad to answer it. So
okay.
Just grateful.
Praise the Lord. Keep him in prayer for the foot pain and some of the depression that he's going through too, Bill. So, go ahead, Steph.
We praise that we made it to Missouri and back.
Yay.
Liz is doing a little bit better. She's still having some health issues. And right now she's kind of in limbo. She's not sure where they're going to put her or what they're going to do or how long it's going to take. So she's getting a little depressed about that, but she's still trying to stay positive.
I'm assuming they are going to recycle her back through basic training?
That's up in the air.
Okay.
She's right now a holdover.
Okay.
So she has no company or no
right.
anything.
Okay. And hopefully they can get to the bottom of whatever the health issues here were too, so. Who else? Get Nicole back there.
Chris is going to be having neck surgery on the 16th. He's been having neck trouble for years and kind of just deals with it. He's had some rounds of injections that helped, sometimes helped, sometimes didn't. And he finally met with the orthopedic surgeon. And he gave him two options. So he's either going to go in and refuse, or he felt very confident in going in and being able to move the nerve that's being pinched. So we're going to go that route first, which is less invasive.
Sure.
So, you can keep him in prayer.
Okay.
Also, Taylor's friend and roommate, Mary Ellen, had to go to the ER the other day. Taylor went with her. She had a migraine pretty much for 24 hours and started twitching. So they went to MedExpress and they sent her in an ambulance to the hospital just for tests. Everything came back good, but she's still having some twitching that comes and goes, and I think she's really scared. So she's going to meet with a neurologist here soon to see, you know, maybe what's causing that, if it's a migraine symptom or whatnot. So.
Especially whenever you're a kid in college too,
yes,
right?
Exactly.
Away from home, so, okay. Catch Kayla right behind you there, Owie.
I'm going to the doctor tomorrow. We had a miscarriage a couple weeks ago, so I have to like go and get checked and stuff, but we're going to also discuss with Dr. Kuzami what our next steps are, so just pray for another pregnancy, a healthy pregnancy this time.
Okay. Sorry to hear the sad news about that, so. Keep Kayla and Steve in your prayers. I know it's got to be pretty stressful through the whole thing there. So, who else? Anybody? Let me share mine. I want to keep Dan Yoder in prayer. He got called up again to go fight wildfires in Montana, traveling this morning, actually. So keep Dan in prayer. He's only home for, what, a week? Or maybe two. How long? What? 2 weeks. And he's back out again, so prayers for him and safety for him and the crew that he's working with. Also, keep our Back to Church Sunday in your prayers for next Sunday, the 15th, that things go well, that we can have a good, solid message, that we can touch hearts and lives for the kingdom, and that that things will go well, that we can have a good crowd here and do what the church is called to do. I want to keep Nancy here in prayer as well for some medical procedures upcoming for her. Also want to keep a little young man that I've been talking about, Jace Haichu, who's been in on my bus for years. He had a bike accident in Jerome two weeks ago. He actually came down Conemaugh Avenue. If you're familiar with Jerome, everything is a hill there. Lost the brakes and chain on his bike and slammed into a car at the bottom of the hill, Veronica's daycare center on Cole Avenue and or at Kime Street, whichever it is. But anyways, he had plates in his head. I got to see him yesterday. They cut him from his ear to ear on his hairline to open him up to put in plates in his head. He looked good. He was up. He stopped to visit me at my house, actually, because I've learned to know him since he was 5 years old with his grandpa buying bait. And he does have some issues still ongoing that they hope will resolve. He lost hearing in his right ear, has a little bit of hearing, but they're hoping the nerves will bring that back. And also now his right eye is turned in. And they're hoping there's some nerve damage to that as well, and they're hoping that that will straighten itself out too. He is supposed to head back to school this week, actually, so we're hopeful that that will all be helpful in healing for him. Want to keep Edie Hubbard in our prayers as well, still in Richland Healthcare. Again, broken leg, so prayers for her. Want to keep Miss Marilyn over here. We've been praying for her and recovering for her knee surgery. It's good to see you here today. I know it's been a little bit of a road for her in healing and recovery. Also want to keep Glenn Stratton in our prayers, who is fighting cancer. He's been on our list too for quite a while. So, Nancy, you have any online by chance?
No.
Okay. Any other ones? Catch Liz back there in the corner, will you?
My son wanted me to tell you his dad passed away yesterday, and his dad and his sister. His grandma tried to do CPR and it didn't work.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. What was his name, Liz?
Wayne Wiley.
Okay. I want to keep the Wayne Wiley family in prayer. That was grandpa, though, right? Okay. So grief in his passing. Okay. We will pray for Pappy Wayne. Okay? How old was he? How old was Pappy? 77. Okay. Anybody else? Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Spend a little time silently yourself with your own praises and requests, and we'll make our way to the message this morning. Join me as we pray. Lord, again, we thank you for the opportunity to be here this morning, to be in your presence, and to just share in fellowship with each other, Lord, our prayer concerns and our testimonies, and just our joys and our concerns as well. It is good that we have this great privilege, Lord, to gather together and to share. Today, Lord, as we are already past now this Labor Day weekend, once again, we're turning our thoughts back towards our work. And Lord, we simply want to lift that up to you today. And again, we just want to pray that you would establish the work of our hands by helping us to be productive people, to be patient people, to be focused, to be insightful to the things that are happening around us. We pray today, Lord, that your Spirit would lead us in our work, in our daily lives, in our families, Lord, in homes, in our community. Help us to be joyful people. Help us to be creative. Help us to be worshipful and constantly remind us, Lord, of your love for us. Help us to realize, help us to get a hold of the idea that you're the reason that we have breath in our lungs. Lord, that's a big thing to think about and a big thing to get a hold of. But I am upright and vertical today, Lord, because of you and your grace and your mercy. And I praise you for that. Lord, today we also pray that you would teach us to align our work and our family and our church life and even our rest in a way that would maximize your glory and allow us to bear the most fruit for your kingdom. Help us to be mindful of your presence around us and the witness that we just share out into the world. Cause our work and our attitude to really enhance the gospel. We can't change the gospel, but people see the gospel in us, Lord, and help us to enhance that people might see it. Help us to shine the light of Christ into this dark and chaotic and desperate world. As we think about our workplaces, Lord, we pray that you would help us to bless our workplaces. Help us to be a blessing. Help us to live a salty life there, a gospel-worthy life in front of our watching co-workers. Help us to be a good witness, and help us to honor our bosses as we honor you. We know that that can be difficult, Lord, but you've called us to work, and you've called us, Lord, to honor those that are in leadership. We pray that you would make our hearts worship and enjoy you throughout the day. Again, knowing that you're the very reason we're alive, and you're the one that I'm really serving as I live and work and move about this land. And as we work, Lord, we pray that you would help us to fix our eyes on Jesus and all of the finished work on the cross that gave us treasure that we really couldn't earn. It's given us rest that we could not otherwise experience, and a living hope that will fuel us to work for the glory of God. Lord, today we pray that you would open our hearts and minds again as we listen to your word. Again, we pray that you would help us to apply it and use it, Lord, for our benefit and for your glory. And today, Lord, as we offer our prayer requests to you, we do so because you're a loving and living God. You're the God of the possible and the impossible. We pray that you would move with mercy and power and love and healing over our prayer list. And we pray that you would be glorified as you do. Lord, we love you and thank you for this opportunity to lift up our thoughts and prayers to you. We ask that you would move in a powerful way today. Move in the hearts of people. Move in the hearts of our community and our nation and our government. Lord, we pray that our faces would turn back to you, that we would bend the knee and worship you and praise you because you are worthy of all praise. Today, Lord, we're grateful and we give you all the thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. As I already said, last week we were talking about being labor ready so that we can serve the God of the impossible. Today, work, labor, employees, those are huge conversations in a lot of places that I go. In my own kitchen, we talk about work and we talk about employees. We talk about it where I work and we talk about it where you work. So I thought maybe I would take this one step further today and talk about what it takes to be a good worker in the workforce. Now, I know some of you are retired, some of you aren't necessarily getting up every day anymore to go to work, and that's okay, because the things that I'm about to talk about today are applied to all of our work where we're employed, our work where we volunteer, our work daily, whatever it is we do. Good laborers with a good work ethic, they seem to be at a premium today in the labor force. So again, today I want to turn the tables a little bit and I want to think about the attitudes that I must have in order for others to enjoy working with me. Do you understand where we are here? We're talking about me today. We're talking about you today. What does it take from me to be a good worker, for others to enjoy working with me? And we can boil this all down to one simple question that we need to ask ourselves. And it's right there on the screen. Am I a jerk at work? Now, I know I'm going to step on a few toes today, probably. And that's okay. That's my job. But the point is, if we're going to be salt and light out there, in the world, my attitude and my behavior needs to be the same out there as it is in here. Amen? It does. And you hear me say that quite frequently. You need to be the same out there as you are in here. I know that's a struggle. It's a struggle for me. I don't always win that. But it's something that we need to think about and be a part of. We need to have the same attitude and behavior out there as we do in here. And here's another reason why. I need to think about my attitudes and my witness in the workforce because the Bible talks a lot more about my responsibilities to others than their responsibilities to me. Let that sink in for a minute. Let that truth sink into you. The Bible talks a lot more about my responsibilities to others than their responsibilities to me. Do you hear that? I wonder how many times in life that I've viewed a problem from the wrong end. When life has gone sideways and I'm frustrated, how many times have I started with the other person when I should have begun with myself? How many times have I looked at a problem from the wrong end? Instead of saying my wife needed to change, perhaps it was I who needed to change. Instead of worrying so much about how someone else should treat me, should I have worried more about how I should be treating other people? The Bible says, love your neighbor as yourself. Is that correct? It doesn't say tell your neighbor to love you. I am not accountable to God for how my neighbor treats me, but I am accountable for how I treat my neighbor. That makes sense? Now, there's lots of similar comments like this in the Word of God. The Bible's full of that stuff and how I am to act, how I am to respond, how I am to treat people. Instead of worrying so much about how my coworkers behave on the job, I need to start to ask myself, how am I doing? How am I doing? Do I behave in ways that make working with me agreeable and productive? And when we start to take this view, it changes the question to, how am I behaving towards others? It changes that question to, how am I behaving towards others, rather than always asking, how are others treating me? And this is huge. It's huge. This change in thinking will revolutionize our relationships with the people that we work with, our emotional well-being, and very much our spirituality. And let me take it a step further. This thought is not just for my place of employment. Okay? How well do I work with each other at home? I said, doesn't matter if you're going to work 8 to 4. How well do you work with the people at home? How well do I work with the people in my community? How well do I work with people at church? How easy am I to work with while I'm volunteering to do something for God? What I'd like you to do is jot down these biblical principles that we're covering today, and then I want you to apply them to your work life. They're real simple and they're real easy. But before we really get there, let's first see where we measure up on the jerk scale. Okay? Can we do that? Now, this is from a 2005 article. That's how long we've been talking about this stuff, and actually way longer than that, okay? And it's an article from a place called fastcompany.com, and it's called, Are You the Jerk at Work? And it goes on and says, we are all jerks sometimes. After all, we're overworked and overstressed, along with everyone else. With competition for good people increasing, it's important to define and assess your own jerk-like behaviors. And once you identify them, decide to change. We've asked thousands of people to describe what they mean by a jerk. And here's a sample of the 50, yes, 50 jerk-like behaviors we've found. How many do you occasionally, accidentally exhibit? They're all on the screen for you at the moment. Flip that up. And they go from left to right. So do some personal inventory. How many do you occasionally accidentally exhibit? Intimidate, condescend or demean, act arrogant, withhold praise, slam doors, pound tables, swear, behave rudely, belittle people in front of others, micromanage, manage up and not down, meaning that you're communicating and kissing up to the people above you that you report to, but you don't share anything with the people below you that you supervise. Always look out for number one. Give mostly negative feedback. Yell at people. Tell lies or half-truths. Act above the rules. Humiliates and embarrasses others. Always have to be in control. How are we doing? The article goes on and says, if you exhibit none of the behaviors above, you're either a saint or you have a few blind spots. Say that again?
Or you work from home.
Your poor husband is correct. In other words, most of us exhibit some of these behaviors some of the time. Let's be honest with ourselves. The question is, how many and how often? And what effect does your behavior have on the people who report to you? The article goes on and says, our ongoing research on this topic is revealing. We continue to ask the survey question, what jerk-like behaviors would make you walk right out the door? What behaviors would make you quit the job you have? And the top five responses are these. People will walk if their boss belittles them in front of others, 40.5%. Lies, 34.2%. Condescends or demeans, 31.5%. Humiliates and embarrasses others, 23.9%. Micromanages, 21.9%. So you can see from that article that working with jerks can be unpleasant. I mean, I didn't share with you all 50 of the jerk responses. But the point is, God doesn't want us to be unpleasant people to work with. We are His representatives wherever we go, whatever we do. So He gives us some clear and practical help on making sure that we are not the jerks at work. So what does the Bible say? Well, first of all, if I'm not going to be a jerk to work with, the first thing that I have to do is mind my own business. Now, I know that some people seem surprised by this, that this is indeed really a biblical principle. But really look at what the Word of God says. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. It says, make it your ambition, make it your goal. Some of your Bibles might say, make it your ambition to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to work with your hands. That means to, some of your Bibles might say, to earn your own living, work with your hands, or earn your own living, just as we told you, so that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders, and so that you will not be dependent on anybody. The point is that I need to learn to do my work and do it well. My work. Do you understand? I don't need to stick my nose in other people's work, not unless I'm in supervision. And even then, micromanaging has proven to be a very ineffective style of leading. Anybody like to be watched over their shoulder, micromanaging what they do all the time? No. Control freaks turn people off. They just do. Control freaks don't motivate people. They irritate people. Sticking my nose in other people's business is an excuse, really, to stop doing my own work. When I'm more worried about your work than my work, I'm not doing my work, right? And the Apostle Paul wrote these words because there was really a unique problem among the Christ followers in Thessalonica. And Paul addresses it further here in his second letter to them in 2 Thessalonians. He kind of wades into them a little bit more. And he says in chapter 3 and verse 10, he says, when we were with you, we gave you this rule. If a man will not work, he shall not eat. We hear that some among you are idle. They are not busy. They are busy bodies. Such people we command and urge in the Lord Jesus Christ to settle down and earn the bread they eat. Now, the problem in the Thessalonian church was some of the Christ followers there had started to misapply the teaching of Jesus' imminent return. Okay? They knew that Jesus was coming back. They thought it was imminent. It was going to be soon. So they were spending all their time trying to see what other people were doing. And the problem was that they thought Jesus could return at any time. But the fact of the matter is that Jesus could return at any time. But that doesn't mean that we're to sit around not working. But that was the justification that they were using. They were giving some of the church members in Thessalonica. They were standing around saying, you know, we're too spiritual to work. We say that in a different way today, but that's really kind of what it is, right? I'm too good to work. I'm too spiritual to work. I'm too whatever to work. But that is not biblical whatsoever. Work is spiritual. You got that? Work pleases God. God created work. He worked 6 days creating the world, and then he rested, and he gave us the same blueprint. 6 days and you rest. He gave us that same blueprint. And the added temptation of idleness here, what Paul is talking about, is that it makes it more likely that I'm going to stick my nose in other people's business. That's one of the dangers when you have too much time on your hands, too much free time. Now listen, the Bible isn't really being harsh here. What it's doing is being very practical. I need to stay busy and mind my own business. When I don't do my work, but try to tell others how to do theirs, guess what? I'm being a jerk. The missionaries who were in Thessalonica, the missionaries themselves started to set the example really when they were establishing the church in Thessalonica. Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, starting in verse 6. It says, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we command you, brothers, to keep away from every brother who is idle and does not live according to the teaching you receive from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to follow our example. We were not idle when we were with you, nor did we eat anyone's food without paying for it. On the contrary, we worked night and day, laboring and toiling, so that we would not be a burden to any of you. We did this not because we do not have the right to such help, but in order to make ourselves a model for you to follow. So, Paul is saying, look, you should be busy doing your work, not lazing around, sticking your nose in other people's work. And they did that, they modeled that, so that people would follow that model, right? Now let me go back for a minute and say, and give you a little disclaimer here. When the Bible says, if a man will not work, he shall not eat, it isn't saying that we shouldn't assist those who can't work. That's not what it's saying. There's all kinds of biblical warnings about our responsibility to serve the sick and to minister to the poor and to take care of our aged parents and our grandparents and to provide for our kids until they're old enough to provide for themselves. There's lots of biblical warnings about that. And the Bible isn't saying that we should become workaholics either. And it's not saying that it's not okay to take some time to rest and to seek some recreation. What it's saying is simply, I should mind my own business and pay attention to what I'm supposed to be doing instead of worrying so much about what others are doing or not doing. It's been said that there are four kinds of bones in the world when it comes to work. And you probably maybe have never heard this, but you can probably apply it where you work. There's the wishbones. They're the people who spend their time wishing someone else would do the work. You know people like that? Then there are the jawbones, who do all the talking, but they do little else. And then there are the knuckle bones, who knock everything that anyone else is trying to do. And then there are the backbones, the people who shoulder the load and they do the work. Make it your goal to be a backbone. And you won't be a jerk at work. That makes sense? Now here's the second thing. If I'm not going to be a jerk at work, I need to make it the Lord's business. And the Bible's pretty clear about this. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 23 says, work what? Willingly. At whatever you do. Your Bible might say with all your heart. Work willingly. As though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. Remember that the Lord will give you an inheritance as your reward, and that the master you are serving is Christ. When I start to see my work as something I'm doing to please God, when I see it as His business, that starts to change everything. When I see myself working for God above everyone else, I don't get as upset or hurt over having my motives misunderstood. Other humans really can't see into my heart. They don't know what's inside of my heart. They don't know what my motives are. Only God can see that. And when I work for Him, I know that He understands what I'm trying to do or why I'm trying to do it, even if everybody else can't. Even if I don't receive a promotion or some pay increase that I think I deserve from the people that I work for, God sees my work. And He will compensate me fairly for it in the end. Maybe you've been passed over for a promotion, or you've been passed over for this promotion by somebody who's sucked up to the boss and, you know, doesn't really pull their load. They got the position that you really deserve. Maybe you should have been given a pay raise or more benefits or more vacation. You've been at this company long enough and you've contributed consistently. Whoever's responsible for those kind of things, they're not seeing it. They haven't caught on yet. What should you do? Should you now work with a chip on your shoulder? Should you now slow down the pace, reduce the effort, disengage from your role, stop taking the initiative, not give it your best any longer? It's what we call today the new trend, quiet quitting. Have you heard that? Quiet quitting, where we kind of show up at work and we don't do any more than necessary and we don't take any initiative. The answer to all that is no. No. But why? Since you're really working to please God, and since you know He's going to reward you fairly, you really can keep on contributing your best to your work. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't hit your boss up for a raise. I mean, sure you can. And if he doesn't give it to you and you deserve it, well, he's going to have to answer to God for whatever his negligence is. Working for God doesn't mean you can't search around for a better job if you need to. I mean, you have that privilege. There's nothing wrong with advancing yourself. But wherever you work, you should give it your best, because you're not just working for men. You're working for God. I need to make my business God's business. And then I don't have to worry whether or not others are doing their fair share when I work for them. Even here in church, Satan creeps up and he says, you know, you're doing a big part of the work, and others are just sitting around. Even if that were true, and it's not, so what? So what? I'm working for God. I'm not distracted by keeping track of who's doing what or who's not doing what. I don't have to brag about anything I've done. God already knows what I've done. I don't need to carry those chips around on my shoulder. Because a person with a chip on their shoulder is what? They're a jerk at work, right? A person who slacks off because they haven't been treated fairly can really be a jerk to work with. Someone who isn't giving it their best because they got their feelings hurt, they're difficult people to work with. Christ followers are called to a higher calling. We don't just work for people. Everything we do for God. Make your work God's business. Amen? And here's the third point. If I'm not going to be a jerk at work, I need to enjoy my work. Here's what God's word says. Solomon writes in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 13, "And people should eat and drink and enjoy the fruits of their labor, for these are gifts from God." Eating and drinking and enjoying the fruits of my labor are gifts from God. If I don't always enjoy my work, and I know that work is not always enjoyable, I can at least enjoy the benefits of having a job. Do you understand that? My wages or my salary provides me with the opportunity to buy food and to take care of my family. Plus, I have a little something to give back to God's work, and I have a little something to contribute to the needs of other people. Now, hear me here. There's also nothing wrong with spending some of my earnings on having a good time. Now, Solomon isn't writing here and recommending a life of sensual gratification or a life of self-indulgent pleasure-seeking. He's not writing about that here in the book of Ecclesiastes. And he's not saying that we should spend our earnings irresponsibly. I mean, sometimes we should be saving instead of spending. He's not saying that the main purpose of our lives should be to have fun all the time so that we can forget about our responsibilities and kind of wash away our problems. What he is saying is, instead of complaining about what we don't have, let's enjoy the things that we do have. Complainers are simply jerks to work with. Anybody here know what I'm talking about? You work with a complainer? God created us with the ability and the intent of enjoying life. And when you get around somebody who's not enjoying life like he or she's supposed to, they're a real pain in the you know what. Don't be a pain. Don't be a pain because of your complaining spirit. Now, it should go without saying, but I'm going to say it anyway. Our party life should take a balanced perspective. We can't party all the time. But we can party sometimes. I mean, when you think about Jesus, where did he perform his first miracle? At a wedding. And what was the miracle? He turned water into wine, making sure that the host didn't run out of refreshments for his guests. Jesus was often found dining with people. It's not taboo to enjoy life. Jesus did. He enjoyed being with people, and I encourage you to do that too. Invite somebody over for supper. Get a movie on Netflix. I know it's hard these days. It's hard to stop and smell the roses. It's a money thing today. It's a time thing today. But don't be a jerk by not enjoying the things that God has given you. Don't complain all the time about what you don't have. Enjoy what you do have. If you're a follower of Christ, you shouldn't complain anyway. You should express faith that God is going to meet your needs. And you should show appreciation for what he's already done for you. I mean, the griping and murmuring and complaining about everything, it not only grieves God, it grieves everybody else. Now listen, I know that we all have bad days. And we all need to be encouraged sometimes. But some people are just chronic complainers. Don't be a chronic complainer. And yes, there are certainly less than ideal circumstances associated with every job. I know some of you have very, 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 very stressful, difficult jobs. The circumstances are less than ideal. But think about the job that God gave Noah with the ark for a minute. That job had its benefits as well as challenges. Do you ever think about the help wanted ad for that job? Huh? Wanted. Person to build, maintain, and sail a large ship. Must be civil engineer with experience as a zoologist. Must have experience in public relations, navigation, and carpentry. Benefits: free 40-day world cruise and free shovel. Must be able to stand noise and foul odors. Above all, must have patience. Why? Because you're going to be stuck on that ark for a year and 10 days. Every job has its demands. But also look for the unique benefits in your job. That represents what our perspective should be regarding our job, whatever job God has given you. Yes, there's going to be things that are noisy and a need for patience, and there's going to be a lot of crap to shovel sometimes. But we should place those things last and look at the 40-day world cruise first. And just another word concerning the demanding and difficult parts of your work. Realize that God can use the demanding nature of your job to build character. To build character in you. It's like the man who made his sons work in the cornfield while their friends were out spending the afternoon in the swimming hole. And someone came and scolded the father and saying, "Why do you make those boys work so hard? You don't need all that corn." And the wise father replied, "I'm not raising corn, I'm raising boys." God is at work in our lives. God is at work even at our place of work. He gives us challenges to mold us into people who are more like his son Jesus. He's also given us opportunities to enjoy life. Our success at not being a jerk at work is learning to accept really the unique challenges of our job as God's will and not complaining about it. Instead, we're to thank God. We're to thank God for the benefits of our work, and we're to allow ourselves really to be happy. And I encourage you to do that. Work is toil, it's hard, but let's make the best of it. So let's go back and recap for a moment. So, am I a jerk at work? Not if you mind. I mind my own business. I make my business God's business. And I enjoy my work. Now, before we close, if God is kind of speaking to you today about your attitude about your work, not only at your job, but even your work for Him, and you want to ask Him to help you change your attitude, perhaps you could take a moment and just pray a little bit about it. And pray something like this from your heart. Dear God, thank you for the work you've given me to do. Help me to mind my own business in my work. I want to do the best that I can do for you without being distracted by what others are doing or not doing. I want my business to be your business, your work to be my work. I want to work for you, God, not other people. I don't want to make it my main goal in life to please others. I want my main goal in life to be pleasing you. Help me to enjoy life and not to complain. I have so much to be thankful for, God. Help me to concentrate on what you have given me to enjoy and not what I don't have. Help me to trust you with my work and all that I have or don't have. In Jesus' name, I ask these things. Amen. Let's stand and sing today.
Some days life feels perfect, other days it just ain't working. The good, the bad, the right, the wrong, and everything in between. Yo, it's crazy, amazing, we can turn our heart through the words we sing. Mountains crumble with every syllable, broken, live or die. So speak life. Other days my thoughts just fall apart. I do, I don't, I will, I won't. It's like I'm drowning in the deep. Well, it's crazy to imagine words from my lips as the arms of compassion. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Hope you live or die. So speak life.
Anybody here a jerk at work? Oh, yes. That was the judge. And I'm sure you've been called a jerk a lot, huh, my friend? Yeah, you got to do it some days, I guess, huh? When you're the judge, anyway. Hey, Allie asked me about this a couple of weeks ago. Thank you very much. I dug it back out. If you want to be included on the one call list, text the word alert to the number 22300. And make sure that you let me know that you've done that so I go in and double check that. And then you'll be on our prayer list, our on-call list, and you'll get the messages that come through phone call or text. So please do that. Let me know if you do. I'm going to update that again probably early this week because we're going to do a one call for Back to Church Sunday next week. So If you want to be in, do that, and you'll get the text alerts, which are much easier many times than the phone call for me, because I can shoot them out pretty much any time of the day or the night. The calls I try to keep between 8, 9 a.m. and 9 p.m., so I'm not calling you in the middle of the night. What else? Liquid dish soap is still being collected for the month of September here, so you've got a few more weeks to do that. I think there are 5 Sundays in September, so we have an opportunity to help out with that. Back to church Sunday next week. Remember a couple of things. One, invite people to come. I'll talk about that in a minute. But we're also going to have the blessing of the backpacks, so make sure that your elementary, middle, high school, college students bring a backpack with them. We're going to have Kathy pray over them, and we're going to put some tags on them and send them off with a blessing. But on the other side of the screen there, it says Back to Church Sunday is a great opportunity to invite unchurched and de-churched people to experience God's love. 5% of Americans have received a personal invitation to church. Only 5%. We're a little weak in that department. 5%. As the church as a whole. So invite. 80% of Americans would be open to attending church if invited by a friend. That means you might have to go the extra mile a little bit. I'll meet you at the door. I'll pick you up. I'll help show you around. That's probably one of the biggest issues, is that kind of fear to get over about showing up here and walking in the door. Invite and then attend with them. Bring them along. Meet them somewhere, whatever. 25% average growth churches see on the event day. That's kind of weak for us. As I already said to you this morning, here it's often 100%. Oftentimes we double what we have for an average attendance on Sundays, on Back to Church Sundays. So invite, and hopefully we can encourage people to come and be a part. 90% of churches say Back to Church Sunday helps members to be more outward focused. That's why I'm leaning on you to be that. Be outward focused. We oftentimes give up asking because we get a lot of no's. But the reality is we need to keep asking. Because at some point God might be opening a door. There might be a situation where the heart is soft. Something might be going on in the family where the door will open and we can get a yes. And that makes all the difference in the world. Nothing changes until we get Jesus involved in it. Amen? What else? Next week, again, save the date, the 15th. Sermon's going to be How to Live and Love in a World That Has Lost Its Way. One of my favorite preachers, Robert Jeffers, First Dallas Church, Baptist Church, has written a book about this. I want to share some of the things that he talks about in there. It also kind of leads itself off into a Ten Commandments series. And I think that it's important that we go back and kind of refocus on the Ten Commandments, especially since this is a presidential election year. He has a lot of good little points, and I want to share some of that with you because I think that it will make a huge impact on who we are as the church and Christians. So, next Sunday, How to Live and Love in a World That Has Lost Its Way. Remember again, Love Feast and Communion is October the 6th. Anything else up there? I think that's it. That it? Anything else we need to know before we go?
Cake list.
Where did the cake and pie list end up? It's on the back table. So hopefully it's been around. You are the hands and feet of God in this county. You are called to soothe suffering, to live with compassion, to build up God's loving peace. Go now and live by faith, patiently trusting in God's promised future. Live by God's teaching and let your love for one another increase. And may God give you grace and peace. May Christ Jesus make you worthy of his call. And may the Holy Spirit fulfill in you every good resolve and work of faith. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Have a great week, everybody. Thanks for joining us online. Be safe. Enjoy the good weather that's coming. Have a great day. We'll see you next week. 10 a.m.